Hello everyone, we are live from Afro Swag Media and Magazine. Today is our very first show of 2020 and even our very first show. And I have the honor to host Martine Kwate. I'll let you greet the people.
Good evening everyone, it is so good to be here on Afro Swag, the first interview of 2020. I'm so honored that I have been selected to start this and, you know, and be a part of this first year anniversary. We're going to say the first commemorative interview of the year 2020. I'm so glad to be here. Thank you so much, Deborah.
It's my pleasure to have you. So, like she said, February is known as the Black History Month, and we are here to celebrate African-American, African in general, African descent, and we'll be hosting every Friday and Monday from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. some amazing entrepreneurs, business owners, and people in our community that are making a difference and are impacting this community. And we have our very first Martine.
Yes. Yes. You know, I just want to, you know, kick off this this first interview of the year for Afro Swag Media Magazine with my experience as an African-American, African living in the diaspora. Some of the things that I've done to contribute in honor of our ancestors, some things that have helped the motherland and the continent, and to help bring consciousness to African-Americans in the United States to become more aware of their roots and their culture, and bring them you know, to the motherland if as possible. So I wanted people to experience that with me. So we started planning how we were going to share this, how we were going to almost like in business, how we're going to sell this idea to people, because it's not a trip to Hawaii or a trip to Jamaica or something. I mean, we're going a lot further, you know, a lot farther, going across the Atlantic Ocean into a country. We, you know, a lot of people don't take that trip. So as African Americans, it's sometimes it can be difficult to wrap our heads around, you know, something like that, traveling back that far, to places where it's not, I would say, a path less traveled. Because we hear about our stories going to the Caribbean, going to, you know, some of the other Caribbean countries. That's nothing, you know, we can do that all day long. But to actually take that pilgrimage to the motherland, that's huge. And so, so my husband and I, we planned, you know, we started, you know, creating our marketing plan of how we were going to execute on getting the word out, and just, and it starts with education. And so with me being a teacher, that was right up my alley, because I could set the you know, the script out, I could set the marketing plans, I could set how, you know, target different groups so that we could, you know, get some traction behind it, maybe find out who would be interested, you know, just kind of identifying that target market of people that would be interested, and you know, even people that like are conscious, those would probably be our you know, we call it low hanging fruit, people that would probably grasp onto the idea a lot faster than maybe the mainstream people or other people. So we devised a plan to how we were going to execute on trying to get the word out and educate people. So we started with our business. We also own an African boutique. So we started educating from events that we would do, selling some of the African items that we brought back from Ghana. And so we would have literature, we'd have brochures, we would have my iPad set up with pictures of, you know, some of the pictures we took while we were traveling there in Ghana. And so people would start to ask, you know, what's this? What is going on? And so that's started the conversation, you know. So once we started getting the word out, we said, okay, now we need to push a little harder, because if we're going to plan this trip, we need to get started. Because a trip like this, in my experience from doing this over and over again, takes about a year to plan. there's so much involved in a trip like this. So we want to make sure that people are well educated. So when they make a decision to travel, they have all the information they need to make an educated decision. So we would set up a meeting, you know, an informative meeting so people can come in and get the information they need. We would answer questions after questions. And when sometimes we already know what the question is going to be, but then there's other questions that we may not think of. So we learned from the audience what type of questions to make sure that we can steer and guide in conversation with, just from the feedback from the people that were there at the information meeting. So we came, you know, I did a full PowerPoint, you know, because I'm an instructor, so of course I had the PowerPoint, I had the material, the brochure, I had everything, you know, that I, you know, people could possibly need to make a decision, maybe go back and share with their family members or a spouse or something like that. But it was important for me to give them as much education about the country. We talked about the climate, we talked about foods that you would eat there, that you would find there, that you would be eating. We talked about commerce, business, doing business. We talked about the currency. The whole exchange rate is it's different than what people may envision, because, you know, every country has their own currency. Right. So explaining to them the conversion rate and how the dollar is more powerful than the Ghana CD, and just kind of explain that a little bit so they could understand the power of the dollar and how far it would go in a country like Ghana.
You know, so you touch a lot. You talk about entrepreneurship, business, the culture, cultural shock, and also the background, the history, and everything else. So, when did you first go to Ghana?
I went back in, let's see, about 2013, I believe, about 6 years ago. I went with my husband, because it was important for me, when I learned from him that he hadn't been back for a while, to see his family, and specifically, more, you know, his mother. She was up in age, and it was very important. I lost my mother at a young age, so it was very important for me to get him to understand that you must go back. My husband, he's kind of a workaholic, so, you know, coming here and grinding and working was his thing. But sometimes we get so involved into working that we forget about our family sometimes. Right. And especially, not intentionally, but it's just because we're on that grind. But especially when your family is so far away, you just, I mean, that kind of a pilgrimage, you have to really plan that out. You can't just say, well, this week I'm going to go see mom. You know, it's not that, you know, it's something that definitely has to be planned, and it's an expensive trip.
It's very expensive.
Very expensive to fly, you know, to Ghana. We paid, you know, anywhere from $1,500 to $1,700 for a ticket, you know. So
tell me, before going, what was your expectation? Were you afraid? Were you in fear of what you're going to discover? Was it for you? Was it like, were you thinking about, okay, if I get there, am I going to live in actual houses? Or what was it like, the preparation? And then when you landed?
I was not in fear. Because I'm an educator, I love learning. I did my research ahead of time, and I have to back up and say, you know, I dated my husband several years before we married, so I was already around Ghanaians located in Omaha. So I already knew the culture, I knew the food, I knew, and I'm an avid researcher, so I kind of prepared myself. And even beyond that, I have a mindset. You know, as an African American, I still have a mindset to learn about other cultures, and I teach this in school, so I, of course, that makes, you know, sense for me to have that mindset because I teach it. But sometimes being African American, thinking about going to the motherland, going to the continent of Africa, sometimes we think we have these ideas because of what's been seen through media,
right?
And so I think it's important that we come of conscious and that we open up our minds to expect things to be different, but not different in a way where you wouldn't want to travel. Okay, do your research if you need to, if you're, you know, interested like I did. I knew Ghana and, you know, forwards and backwards by the time I was finished. So some people, some of my husband's friends, Ghanaian friends, will say, she knows more about Ghana than you do. Because
you know, I thought the same thing when I first met you. I was like, oh my God, she can talk about Africa, Ghana more than I do. So it's very interesting. So when you were in Accra, you were in Accra and other cities, what was commerce like, business?
Okay, so Accra is the capital of Ghana. For those that don't know, some people may pronounce it Accra, but it's Accra. I'm gonna say that it's Accra. So, you know, learning about the currency was the first step. Learning how powerful the dollar is, meaning the exchange rate. Okay, right now it's sitting at 5%. So, just to put it in context so that everyone can understand, US dollar, $1, okay? Or if I take $100 to Ghana CD and convert it over, or excuse me, US dollars and convert it over to Ghana CDs, it's 500 Ghana CDs. So so the dollar, US dollar is very powerful. 500 Ghana CDs goes a long way in Ghana. So just imagine commerce-wise, if someone wants to come and do business in Accra or surrounding areas, bringing your US dollars and converting over what you could do to start a business. We know how expensive it is to start a business here in the United States and how far our money will go because the prices of things, brick and mortar, rent and all that, leasing and buying equipment or whatever, depending on the business that you're in. But just imagine being able to quadruple, more than quadruple that same money in another country and buying things, equipment and everything and starting finding a place to set up shop. You could do a lot with that money. And so that's a business opportunity for people because you're that much more wealthier over there. So because a lot of times in the US, businesses struggle because of funding. And the money's just not there because it's so expensive. But just imagine being able to have that much more money and be able to thrive because now you have the funding that you need. You have the capital that you need to get started and do the things that you want to do to help the community or to give back or whatever that you know, venture that you're taking on. But I found that to be amazing, especially being a businesswoman like myself. So we, you know, we have a business over in Ghana. I mean, I have my, you know, our business is here in the U.S., but we flipped that and we started a business in Ghana as well because...
So you went global,
international. Yes, international. And I don't talk about it a whole lot, but we did. And so it's a storage business. So we have some land and we built three storage units. This is like here in the United States, and you know, people that travel a lot, military people that are in and out, they may put their things in storage units because they may only be here temporarily. So that's exactly what we did over there, and we rent it out.
That's very neat. You're giving me ideas. So tell me, I remember one of your live streams from Accra, you were standing in front of a store and then a lady had just arrived and she was parking her Mercedes. I remember your live stream and you were like, oh, you see, that's a Mercedes. Tell me about that experience.
So I was live streaming in front of my favorite restaurant, American restaurant, KFC. There's a KFC in Accra, Ghana, Osu, the area of Osu on Oxford Street. So I was in the parking lot, standing a little, you know, and partly in the parking lot. And so she's driving up, this young lady, she had to be no more than 30, very young lady. And she pulls up and you know, really close to me. So I'm trying to, you know, get out of her way. And I noticed that she's driving a Mercedes. And so when I'm live streaming, I say, oh, wow, look, she's driving a Mercedes. I told you there's money to be had here. There's people making money. There's rich people here.
Right, exactly. And also one of the things I've always wanted to ask you is the language, the accent. Mm-hmm. So when you first got there, were you able to understand people, and what was the experience trying to understand the American accent?
Well, first of all, when I opened up my mouth, they knew I was a foreigner. That's the kind, you know, the idea. Mm-hmm. Oh, foreigner, because I don't have an accent, the African accent, of course, because I'm African American. But I could understand, to answer your question, I could understand when Ghanaians speak, because I've been around my husband so long, I pick up on the accents. I understand, because sometimes with the, you know, with your ear, if you've never been around people that have accents, you may not understand them right away, and it's a learning ear. I mean, you know, so I didn't have that part was easy because I had been around him so long. My dad, if he comes into town, he'll sometimes ask me, what did he say? Because sometimes the accent is so heavy on some of our brothers and sisters from the motherland that you don't pick it up right away. And Ghana was colonized by the British. So my husband has that British but African accent. Right. So it's a combination of the two.
It is a combination. Mm-hmm. And now think of someone like me. I'm from Togo. Mm-hmm. And Togo was colonized by the French.
Right.
So in addition to the French accent, I have Togolese dialects, like more than 40 dialects. I don't speak all 40, but I speak 7 different languages from 4 different countries.
Wow.
So think about that. And my first experience...
Wow.
My first experience coming to the U.S., it was a cultural shock. And you think you speak the same language, like English, with a different accent. People are unable to understand you. Once you open your mouth, it's like, what?
You know, it's funny that you say that, and I commend you for being able to speak, you know, so many different languages. You said 7 languages. Seven, and my husband speaks 3 or 4, English, his mother tongue, French, and then... maybe he knows a little bit of Twi, which is a universal language in Africa, West Africa. But we have the same, you know, as Americans, we're, you know, some of us struggle with just speaking English. So if we try to pick up a second language, that's like, I can't do it. I'm trying to learn another language, and it's very difficult. So I commend, and you know, our brothers and sisters from the motherland that speak several different languages. That's just awesome. But you know, even though sometimes we can't understand the accents from our brothers and sisters from the motherland, we get the same thing here. Just travel south enough, you know, our, you know, African Americans that are from the southern countries, their southern dialect is so hard. It's hard for me to understand it. I'm a northerner, so we're all in the same country, but because of the dialects and just where they, you know, where they live, you know, we may say pig Latin, we may, you know, we have some funny terms that we give them, but or broken English, in other words. So sometimes it's even hard to understand people right here in the United States that may just live in southern states, you know. So so you know, we don't, you know, and that might be the case. We may not understand because you have an accent, and that's for any language really, or any ethnic group. Hispanic, Latino, sometimes they have when they speak English, the accent is the Spanish accent. So sometimes we don't understand them. You know,
sometimes I like teasing people when they ask me, like, where's your accent from? And I'll just go, I don't think I have an accent. You have an accent.
Right. We get that, you know, we think it's y'all, or you know, it's you. But then you're thinking like, no, wait a minute, it's probably you. I mean, so it can go both ways. I see that.
And then when I see the expression on their faces, I'm like, okay, let me explain this to you. If you were to be in my country, you'll be the only one with an accent.
That's right. And that happens. And so, like I said, when I go over there to Ghana, when I speak, they automatically know that just like we would automatically know because of your accident, your accent. So yeah, and I, you know, sometimes I don't speak. I just I bring a Ghanaian with me and have them speak for me. Sometimes I can say some things like "ayahi" means how much, you know. So when I'm shopping, I, you know, I do pretty good, you know.
That's good, ayahi. I love.
Yeah, we have, you know, there's the haggling going on with the prices, and so sometimes we, you know, we may get taken advantage of because of our accent.
For those that are just joining, this is live from AfroSwag Media and Magazine. This is our very first show of 2019 when we started, and this is our first show, and we are honored to have Martin Poitier.
The Family Dollar stores, and everyone knows Family Dollar, but they're probably in all parts of the U.S. But particularly, this one was being targeted, and it's right down the street from the radio station, so that's our neighbor. And so, and then there was a second location off of 35th and Leavenworth that was also targeted. Applications were submitted to City Council as a request to be able to sell beer and wine out of those stores, and we you know, went to the community through radio and said, look, this is not something that we need in our community, and we need our voices to be heard. If you, you know, agree with this, then show up to the meeting, the City Council board meeting. The outcome was great because they showed up. There was a lot of people in attendance from the Omaha area, North Omaha area, from the community that represented the cause of stopping this from happening, from being approved. And so everyone had a chance to, they had 3 minutes to go up and speak. So everyone, you know, City Council, they have to allow the public to speak. And so whoever's there can get through their 3 minutes, you know, time to state their opinion and why they felt that this request, this application should be rejected. The result was that the City Council did not approve the application, and we were so excited and we rejoiced the next day on the radio station. I commended everyone for showing up because that's what it takes, a community coming together under one voice. And it's very, very powerful, and some people think that their voice doesn't matter, and they'll even say my vote doesn't count, but it really does when we come together collectively as a group.
It does, and those that, I mean, have the ability and opportunity to vote, I mean, your voice counts, your vote counts.
Absolutely. So that was phenomenal, and it just proves that it can be done. That was evidence right there.
When we come together, let's set aside our, I don't know, ego.
Right.
Yeah, let's set aside those things and talk about and focus on what matters.
That's right.
Right.
Yes.
Any last word before we end the show?
I just want to say, with in honor of Black History Month, that we support our small Black businesses. Again, I always come from that angle because I'm a small Black business. But we have, an you know, all around, but in particular, Omaha, Nebraska, with it being a smaller city, and you know, we do have a lot of Black people that live in Omaha, and we have a lot of talented Black people, Black smart people. And so, and that's, you know, our Black Americans, that's Africans coming in that live here now. All of us, we're very talented, and so a lot of us will launch businesses. And as you can see, if you watch the show enough, you'll see us bringing in, you know, on a daily basis, small business owners. So there's, you know, there's a wealth of businesses, small Black businesses. So go out and support Black History Month, and even beyond the month, not just Black History, but that's the month that they gave us to, you know, to, on the calendar to celebrate. But we want to celebrate beyond February, the whole entire year. But specifically, you know, February, let's get out, let's support. There's a lot of events, a lot of Black expos around town. Vendors are popping up, doing pop-ups around. We have an event tomorrow. So go out and support a Black business, because that's how we make our money. That's how we stay in the game. That's how we stay in business. And a lot of times, you know, that's how we eat.
That's how we eat.
That's how we eat.
I love it. As an African, that's what we'll say. That's how we eat.
Yes, right. That may be their only income, you know. So go out and support them. It just shows that you appreciate them being there. They're being an entrepreneur and trying to make money on their own, you know, as an individual.
It's amazing. So thank you so much for joining us again, Martin.
Thank you for having me here.
It was an honor. And like we said, Afro Swag Media and Magazine, the Ethnic Wave. Let's engage with the community. Yes. Let's narrate our own story.
Yes.
And let's empower one another. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.